Hello everybody, Teagan here with High Point Scientific. Thank you so much for tuning in to tonight's episode of What is in the Night Sky this month. Tonight I'm going to be taking you on a beautiful tour of the universe and the night sky in the month of October. We'll be leaving Earth and journeying past our solar system, and we're going to visit a few deep sky objects. Then we're going to bring it back closer to home, and then we're going to see what the moon and the planets are up to. So as always, buckle in and let's see what's really out there. Due to the gas giant Jupiter dominating the night skies, we're going to see what the moon and the planets are up to first. Venus, typically the brightest planet, spends almost the entirety of October in Virgo and is lost within the sun's glare this month. In contrast, Saturn, the most distant and dimmest planet visible to the naked eye, can be seen throughout the evening. It was at its best a few months ago, but it continues to shine at a respectable magnitude 0.6, and it's still worth taking a closer look at through a telescope. Now, if you haven't seen Saturn through a telescope before, especially a larger one, you are in for an absolute treat. You can see the ring system and the Cassini division within that ring system. If your telescope is large enough, you can even see some surface detail. Saturn is one of those views that you will never forget. Neptune, having reached opposition last month, is visible throughout the evening, but you'll need binoculars to spot it among the faint stars of Aquarius. Being the most distant planet, it appears a little more than a star-like point in all but the largest telescopes, and changes very little in brightness. Next up is Jupiter, which also reached opposition last month and continues to shine like a brilliant golden star in the evening sky. Still moving slowly through western Pisces and with no bright stars nearby, it is an unmistakable sight in the southeast after sunset. And finally, Uranus is drifting through the barren southeastern quadrant of Aries, and like Neptune, will require binoculars to spot it. But Mars, on the other hand, is brightening and can be easily seen with the naked eye between the horns of neighboring Taurus. It won't reach opposition until early December, which gives us a perfect opportunity to watch the planet grow brighter and larger as the distance between our two worlds closes. A waning gibbous moon appears just 3 degrees away on the 14th. And as for the moon itself, it turns full on the 9th and then new again on the 25th. So as we travel past our solar system, 1,100 light years away in the constellation of Cygnus, we stumble upon Messier 39, an open cluster. Best observed in the late summer, it can still be high over the horizon during the cooler autumnal months. This cluster is bright enough to be seen with the naked eye under dark skies. With binoculars, the cluster is large enough to appear elongated and resolvable into a smattering of blue-white stars. Now from Messier 39, we travel to NGC 7009, the Saturn Nebula. While being situated in an area devoid of bright stars, the Saturn Nebula can be found within the same 10 by 50 binocular field as magnitude 3.8 Epsilon Aquarii. You'll probably need a magnification of at least 100 times to see the protrusions that give this gorgeous planetary nebula its name. If you want to give this planetary nebula a shot, use a narrowband filter and averted vision to get the best results. A small scope can show hints of a beautiful blue-green color, but you will need a large scope, upwards of 15 inches in aperture, if you want to see the central star. Now, traveling away from NGC 7009, we visit the constellation of Cassiopeia. A gorgeous open cluster exists there, known as Messier 52. Located in Cassiopeia, close to the border with Cepheus, a small telescope at low power will show this cluster as having a conical shape with a bright yellowish star at its tip. Look carefully, and you'll notice a multitude of fainter stars scattered across the background, making this one of the must-see sights of the fall. Next is NGC 7662, the Blue Snowball. Another of the brighter autumnal planetary nebulas, the Blue Snowball can be found close to Kappa Andromedae and appears as a bluish, almost perfect circular disk. If you are looking for a planetary that truly lives up to its name, then this is it. Even a small scope at around 50 times will show a tiny, clearly defined disk. Mid-size scopes will also show this nebula to be comprised of rings. As with most planetary nebulae, you will need a large scope and a high magnification to catch a glimpse of its central star. Now, the last object that we visit is not a star cluster, nor is it a nebula of sorts. It is a single star, also called the Garnet Star. This Garnet Star has a strong reddish color and is known to be a semi-regular variable. Its magnitude erratically ranges from 3.4 to 5.1 over a period of about 860 days. The Garnet Star is a red supergiant and one of the largest stars visible with the naked eye. Its variability is caused by a shelf of material that the star itself has ejected over the past 2 or 3,000 years. Right now, it has an estimated brightness of magnitude 4, but that could change. So that is it for our tour of the night sky in October. Maybe you have photographed or visually observed some of these objects. I know the Blue Snowball Nebula and the Garnet Star are pretty spectacular through a large telescope, from personal experience. Now that being said, if you have any questions or need advice viewing any of these objects, please let us know in the comments. Like and subscribe to our YouTube channel so you don't miss any future content. Thank you so much for tuning in, and clear skies.